Yeah. Hey, Krista, it's Andrea. We're just heading out from Gainesville Carp.
As I understand it, the Lake Simcoe Stewardship Network, or the Lake Simcoe Network, is trying to kind of ensure that there's a bit of streamlining and seamlessness between the organization, as much as possible, with so many different organizations, to try and produce a little bit of seamlessness between the efforts that are going on around the lake. That's my understanding of it, and this will be a little bit of a showcase to show some of the projects that are going on and to compare notes to see where we can work together better, differently, that kind of thing. I wasn't involved with a lot of the preparatory meetings for this tour, so I sort of came in on the back end of it to help, because I'm familiar with a lot of the sites that I've collaborated on anyway through this area. I'm implemented through the Ministry of Natural Resources. Some of them have other funds from other organizations. I couldn't even tell you the slew of them. Some of them are going to have provincial funding through the Environment Farm Plan. Some of them will have municipal funding through the Conservation Authorities programs, and others.
So federal and provincial.
And municipal. Sometimes private dollars go in, especially, well, I can't neglect that, because there are a lot of landowners who participated in these projects. And so their dollars have gone into a lot of them. And for instance, with the Conservation Authorities Lake Simcoe Cleanup Fund.
Sylvia, can you use the microphone? It's right
here. Hi guys, is that better?
Yeah, I can hear you.
That makes a difference, eh? We're just getting to the site that's actually been completed. The one we just passed there on the right is something that will be worked on. There will be plantings that go on that berm, but I'm sure when the other people and Frank and them come on board, they'll explain that more. Just a little bit about the network. The network runs, it started with a grant through Ontario Tulum Foundation and through Not of Us on the Futures holds that grant. And so basically the network, it involves two watersheds. We're on the Lake Simcoe watershed as well as the Nottawasaga Valley Conservation Watershed. And we basically encompass five municipalities in South Simcoe between those two watersheds. And it is a collaborative partnership with a lot of different volunteer partners, agencies, organizations in South Simcoe. So we have Andrea Guinan here, who's helping us. She actually sits as a representative with Lake Simcoe on our committee. Ducks Unlimited and the South Simcoe the Dufferin South Simcoe Land Stewardship Network, who also sits on our committee. We have Steelheaders, we have the Nottawasaga Valley Conservation Authority. We have all the municipalities, the five municipalities represented on our committee, and that really, really helps. It gives that municipal link, which is so important. And we have organizations like the Lions and on our committee as well. So it's about 20 people plus, and we function collaboratively, looking to do stream restoration works and prioritize given all the expertise that is on our committee. So basically, this is a canal work. I'm going to leave it to Frank to explain, but they did the main one, and this is with the Drainage Act, that's it. So this committee that Frank is on is a combination of Bradford and King Township. So here you see the canal on your right, and this canal, you can see the shrubbing that's been done on the other side. Because what's going to happen is we're very close to the side here, and they're going to move that canal over to where you see all that shrubbing that's been done, or the clearing that's been done on the other side. And so when we drive by here in a few years' time, there's a blue heron, by the way, anybody wants to see in the water there on the right? So what you're going to see down the road when you come here in a few years' time is actually a berm and a buffer between the canal on this side where access will be for clean out and stuff in the future, but also we're trying to naturalize it and help the canal be a vibrant vibrant part and water water quality. So we are going to, we're coming down here. This stretch is actually going to be, I'll keep going. One of the reasons that this whole drainage area, this is a huge project with many, many partners from Ministry of Environment through to Ag, through to all the big players, municipal affairs, the canal is a mega project here, and we're really fortunate through the South Simcoe Streams Network to be a small part of that by being able to have the community come in and help and be aware of plantings and regenerate what's been done with the works that have been done. Yeah. The question was, is the canal being moved just for? Oh, hold on a second. Yeah, keep on going straight. Whether or not the canal is being moved just for road purposes, and the answer to that is no. This canal was built, I guess, back in the 50s, if not before that, and it has been filling in, and there's been a lot of issues with it. So this is just the fact that it's actually encroaching on the road here is just one of many things that have been happening to this canal. It's been filling in. They needed to do different works, and of course, being that it goes into Lake Simcoe, they want to do the work in such a way that they're mitigating phosphorus impacts and all that, and doing works that will create an environment that is healthy. So what we're going to see is actually the end result. Well, here again, you can see that they're getting ready to do work probably next year. Frank will know for sure because he's a pro. But you can see that they are going to be moving this canal over, and as part of the work. This canal helps for irrigation of the.
It doesn't drain the water.
No. Thank you.
The farmland is lower than the canal. She'll explain it.
So what's the function of the canal?
Bill Franken.
The canal was it's a man-made canal built for irrigation for the marsh in part. That was part of its purpose for irrigation purposes. Somebody from WMAFRA may be able to speak better to that, but and it's that is, as far as I know, its main function, right?
Well, it's a little more complicated.
Okay.
Yeah,
good for it.
Hi, Bruce Kelly from Ontario Soil and Crop. The canal is actually fairly complicated. This is a polder marsh, so the marsh is below the level of the river. So the river does not drain the marsh. The canal actually diverts the upland water around the marsh and then provides water supply to the marsh over the course of the summer. But the actual marsh is drained. And that's an interesting thing. You talk about committees, because the actual water level in the ground to your left is decided by a committee. So as the course of the year goes on, they decide what the actual water level in the ground is going to be. And that is adjusted manually by all the little valves you see. So then you see these pipes that go out into the marsh and these various little connections and culverts that we just drove over. And those are actually sort of an unlimited water access for irrigation.
Thanks. We're actually getting very close to where the demonstration site is. Once we look at, basically what's happened here is this is going to be the next phase of the works of the berm being built. And Frank can speak more to that. But this is we're coming up now to the actual restoration, and you'll see sort of a final product. So you'll see now, you're going to see a berm on your right coming up soon. And that is part of the works that the South Central Streams Network and many, many, many partners were involved in. I can go into that in more detail for you. But this is the final result here. So we helped organize through many partners, and I will go into that. This is what you see here. This is the final product. Yeah, they're with us. That's Jackie. So we are at the site.
So this is the only place along the canal
that
you can do the work on?
For the South Simcoe Streams Network, yes. However, there are other sites that the Lake Simcoe Conservation Authority and staff have worked on. This one is one that we came in on for trying to recreate a naturalized area using a native species. And as you can see, I can speak to that if you want. But let's wait till the others get on board just before I do that. Meters of a treed buffer plant. This is along the canal here. And what you see is in here is about 100 large native stock and 700 potted shrubs. And what we is kind of unique is you've got your dry berm kind of conditions, so you need certain type of species, and then you've got your wetland type conditions. So we've actually done a very good mix of shrubs and trees here. In order to get this done, this was done in 2009, 2010, summer, fall, and then 2010 we came back to do a little bit more. So we had over 200 volunteers on this site and over 1,000 volunteer hours. We've had at least 16 plus community partners. One of them's coming up here right now. This is Frank Jonkman, who's just coming in. So I guess just from a network point of view, I really wanted to say this could not have been done without funds from ELSCUF. We've got about 10K of funds from Ministry of Environment ELSCUF funds in this project. And we have also through the Lake Simcoe, the MNR Lake Simcoe Community Stewardship Program. And we also have 18.25K of provincial money through OMAFRA and MNR, and we also contributed here were the in-kind from MNR of about 4,500 through the Stewardship Ranger program, because we had three crews working on this in the summer to help put in these big trees and stuff that you see here. We also have, total expenditures, we had about $28,000, and total in-kind, we had about $34,500 from all the different partners, and the $45,000 from the in-kind, so about a $67,000 project here that you see, but it's certainly well worthwhile. It looks great. It's had a lot of different school groups came in here. We had high school students, public school students. We've had the town of Bradford, West Willenbury, and King have been our partners on this. Lake Simcoe Regional Conservation Authority partnered on this. So this was a very, very big big project with lots of partners that really worked well.
Good morning. Thanks, Sylvia, for the introduction. Frank Jonkman, in case anybody didn't catch it. This piece here is a test piece that was done in 2008 as part of a, right now Bradford and King Townships are going through a $26 million project of relocating the canals. When you were coming down the road, you probably noticed that the canals were right beside the road, and as we drive on, you'll notice that on the balance. This was done as a test piece. That's a project being done through the Drainage Act. And as I said, this was done in 2008 to test methods, techniques, and for costs. Because through the Drainage Act, there is a mechanism in there to protect the landowners, because all of the $26 million in costs are being assessed back to the landowners. It's a user pay system. Anybody that benefits from drainage is contributing to this project. With that said, we did receive 10 points. $4 million from the municipal M3I, we call it the Municipal Infrastructure Incentive Initiative, I believe it is. OMAFRA pays a third grant on all agricultural properties. So at the beginning, the farmers were looking at about a $560 an acre assessment for drainage. Through the grants, various grants, we're able to get that down to $106 an acre now. The important part, and Sylvia's contribution and conservation's contribution, is the Drainage Act doesn't necessarily allow for restoration. You know, we'll go in there and seed it, but that's the extent of it. And the way the Drainage Act is set up, it's unfortunate, but they don't view planting trees and shrubs and you know, actually doing a restoration to the area necessary as part of the cost that can be assessed back to landowners. The challenge is there are about 9,600 landowners that are impacted through this project. Any one of those landowners can appeal the project and likely would have appealed the project had we had a revenue stream in there for restoration, because some of the farmers don't think it's necessary. There are a number of farmers, you know, that do like it. However, we can't charge that back to them. It's through the South Simcoe Streams Conservation and other partners that we've been fortunate, I say, in being able to find funding and resources to do restoration. And that little piece that we stopped at along there, hopefully by the time we're done, the entire perimeter is going to look that way.